Hi, my name is Pradeep Natarajan. I'm the Director of Preventive Cardiology at Mass General Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. The learning objectives for this talk are: recognize that LDL cholesterol lowering represents a key strategy in secondary prevention. Identify therapies demonstrated to reduce LDL cholesterol and improve cardiovascular prognosis. And recognize key LDL cholesterol targets for secondary prevention. Let's start with some biology. Let's talk about lipoproteins. Lipoproteins are large macromolecules that house the blood lipids, triglycerides and cholesterol. Triglycerides and cholesterol are insoluble in the blood, so they need to be shuttled around through these lipoprotein particles. On the outside of the lipoprotein particles are phospholipids, unesterified cholesterol, as well as apoproteins. These are proteins that are associated with the lipoproteins that determine the function of the particles themselves. The particles come in different names, largely based on their density, like low-density lipoprotein, or LDL, high-density lipoprotein, or HDL. Now, in the blood, we measure cholesterol, triglycerides, LDL cholesterol, that's the amount of cholesterol within the LDL particles, and HDL cholesterol, that's the amount of cholesterol within the HDL particles. Now, the relative contribution and the relative distribution of each of these factors is determined by a wide variety of metabolic factors, and they're importantly influencing cardiovascular disease risk for the patient. Now, separately, another definition, secondary prevention. This is how it's defined in the guidelines. So this is clinical atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Patients who have previously had myocardial infarction, stable or unstable angina, coronary or other arterial revascularization, a stroke or TIA of atherosclerotic origin, aortic aneurysm of atherosclerotic origin, and peripheral artery disease. Now, with increasing use of CT, many of our patients who have not had a clinical cardiovascular disease event are recognized to have subclinical atherosclerosis. Importantly, in the 2018 guidelines, this is not strictly recognized as secondary prevention, but it's recognized that there are many individuals who have a very high burden of subclinical atherosclerosis and that their cardiovascular disease risk often approximates patients who have had clinical events. And so it's important to recognize these cases on a case-by-case basis currently. Now, LDL cholesterol lowering with statins have been the cornerstone for secondary prevention for decades. Using analyses across multiple randomized controlled trials of statins, it's recognized for every 40 milligram per deciliter lowering of LDL cholesterol, major adverse cardiovascular disease events are reduced by 25%, and all-cause death is reduced by 10%. In addition to statins, dietary management is key in reducing recurrent cardiovascular disease events. Many of the features related to a heart-healthy diet also leads to lower LDL cholesterol, but there are many other features that promote improve cardiovascular prognosis really in the absence of substantially changing the blood lipids. Key features that will improve hyperlipidemia include lowering saturated fats, minimizing trans fats, also reducing refined carbohydrates will also improve the balance of the lipids as well too. Importantly, replacing those deleterious fats with polyunsaturated fats are an important recipe for a heart-healthy diet. Other non-statin molecules have also been shown to lower cardiovascular disease risk in addition to LDL cholesterol. This is ezetimibe. This is an inhibitor of NPC1L1. It was observed among patients with cardiovascular disease in addition to a statin, modestly lowering LDL cholesterol and also modestly lowering cardiovascular disease risk. Two other related medicines, these are PCSK9 monoclonal antibodies, over a shorter period of time during their studies, led to greater LDL cholesterol lowering and greater cardiovascular disease risk reduction. Some of the differences in comparing with statin clinical trials, which are often carried out for about 5 years, is that differences in potency for the medicines, as far as how much it lowers LDL cholesterol, differences in the follow-up as well, are important in determining cardiovascular disease relative risk reduction as it relates to LDL cholesterol lowering, making it hard to do a direct comparison across all of these for the event reduction. This is a schematic representation of how lipids should be managed for patients with clinical atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. This is taken from the 2018 American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association cholesterol guidelines. Among patients with clinical atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, as we had defined, are all eligible for maximally tolerated statin therapies, with the goal of lowering by greater than 50%. So this is largely what's termed a high-potency regimen. There are many patients who don't achieve at least 50% lowering for their LDL cholesterol. In those patients, ezetimibe is recommended to be added on top of those individuals. Now, there is a key description of very high-risk atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Patients who would benefit from LDL cholesterol lowering in addition to greater than 50% to achieving less than 70 milligrams per deciliter. Now, there are some differences in that actual number across the world. In the U.S., we use less than 70. In the European Society of Cardiology, that number is less than 55. So you'll see some differences, but this is based on U.S. guidelines and largely what payers also use for their metrics. So what is very high-risk atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease? These are patients who are at risk for multiple recurrent cardiovascular disease events and who merit the add-ons of potentially more expensive therapies. So these are individuals who have already had multiple events or individuals who have had a major event and have multiple high-risk conditions, putting them at risk for even more events. These individuals may benefit from more costly medicines such as PCSK9 monoclonal antibodies. A word on some of the other lipid fractions that we test, HDL cholesterol and triglycerides. In the population, HDL cholesterol concentration is correlated inversely with cardiovascular disease risk, meaning individuals at higher HDL cholesterol concentrations typically have lower or reduced cardiovascular disease events. However, over the last decade or so, investigators have tried many different agents to pharmacologically increase HDL cholesterol. None of those have shown to improve cardiovascular disease prognosis, except for one, which also happened to lower LDL cholesterol. Elevated triglycerides are a potent risk factor for recurrent cardiovascular disease events. They are inversely correlated with HDL, and there's an abundance of research that suggests that that might be the causal blood lipid fraction that is important for recurrent cardiovascular disease events. Fish oils over the counter, as well as pharmacologically, have been used to treat hypertriglyceridemia. One such preparation, a pharmaceutical, icosapent ethyl at high dose, this is purified EPA of the omega-3 fatty acid preparations, was shown to modestly lower triglycerides among patients who had elevated triglycerides, but also lower cardiovascular disease events among patients who also had cardiovascular disease. Importantly, the seminal trial that demonstrated that finding was published after the latest cholesterol guidelines were released. So it's not yet incorporated in the guidelines, but is approved and is available in clinical practice. Another important lipoprotein is called lipoprotein little a. This is an LDL-like particle that's been associated with recurrent cardiovascular disease risks. It's not detected by the current conventional lipid panel and requires a separate blood-based assay. An abundance of preclinical data suggests that this may be a causal fraction for recurrent cardiovascular disease events. Turns out that PCSK9 monoclonal antibodies happen to reduce lipoprotein little a, and that individuals who have high lipoprotein little a actually may derive greater clinical benefit from PCSK9 monoclonal antibodies. However, these medicines are not currently approved to treat isolated elevated LP little a. If patients happen to have insufficient LDL cholesterol lowering who also happen to have high lipoprotein little a, it may be a double benefit for those patients. There are ongoing prospective randomized controlled trials that are testing the hypothesis that specifically LP little a lowering will reduce recurrent cardiovascular disease risk. So in summary, lipoproteins are complex macromolecules and evidence strongly implicates ApoB containing lipoproteins. ApoB represents one of the proteins that is the key determinant of atherogenic lipoproteins, particularly LDL. These are implicated in atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Dietary optimization should complement pharmacotherapies. LDL cholesterol less than 70 and greater than 50% reduction with statins, plus or minus ezetimibe, is key for secondary prevention. And particularly for patients who have very high risk features, PCSK9 monoclonal antibodies may be appropriate. Key lipids are important in the identification of patients for recurrent events. That's lower HDL, higher triglycerides, higher LP little a. In the current ACC-AHA guidelines, these lipid fractions are not therapeutic targets for improving cardiovascular disease risk, But there is important published literature and ongoing research really teasing this out. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this educational video helpful.